Hi, everyone. I got Fluffy, I got Chocolate. Well, and we're only 18 days until the spring equinox on March 20th. And that means my spring equinox broadcast will be March 24th. So can all of you who haven't subscribed, please click on the red subscriber rectangle in the lower right corner of your screen or wherever it might be in your computer or cell phone or iPad. We're almost to 170,000 subscribers now, but our goal has been 175,000 by the spring equinox broadcast. If you all ask others you know to subscribe now, and ask them to reach out to their friends and family and colleagues, we could make that 175,000 subscriber goal. So please, everyone, right now, click on those subscriber buttons and help others subscribe after this broadcast. On the COVID battlefront, there is also good news that President Joe Biden announced this week. He has brokered an agreement between Johnson and Johnson and their longtime competitor Merck to work together to increase the supply of Johnson and Johnson's new coronavirus vaccine that received emergency approval this week. But even this collaboration between pharmaceutical competition of the new Johnson and Johnson vaccine with Merck made from an adenovirus until later this summer is when they think that they will actually have a good supply. But several states are already pushing to open up more, including California, Massachusetts, Michigan, North Carolina, and South Carolina. Even as Dr. Fauci and other medical experts have been warning that opening up too soon yet again could cause a dreaded fourth wave of COVID, fueled by all of the mutated variants from South Africa, Brazil, and England that are more contagious than the original COVID-19. Yesterday, March 2nd, the Washingtonian headlined that the South African COVID variant has officially reached Northern Virginia. It is puzzling to experts about how the local resident contracted the South African COVID variant because that person had not traveled anywhere. The South African strain keeps mutating, and one of its variants known as 501Y.B2 appears to be about 50% more contagious, rapidly getting into human cells. Another South African variant, B1351, has already been identified in Washington, D.C. and Maryland, and a dozen other states, and expanding. Concern about the South African variant is growing among medical experts because new data indicates that the AstraZeneca COVID-19 vaccine, distributed in the U.K., provides only, quote, minimal protection, close quote, against the mutating South African variant. The reason is that several RNA genes have changed in the South African variant's COVID spikes, and that makes it easier for the insidious coronavirus mutation to get into human cells. The mutating South African variants could be avoiding some or all of the natural antibodies that people developed after COVID infections. Looking at blood from 44 South Africans who recovered from COVID-19, more than 90% showed reduced immunity to the new South African variant, and almost half had no protection at all against it. It's why every one of you, all of us everywhere, must be extremely careful. Here is a list of the most contagious COVID variants so far. B.1.1.7 from the UK, B.1.351 from South Africa, and P.1 from Brazil and Japan. As of March 2nd, 2021, the CDC has a total case count in emerging COVID variants causing 2,000 581 cases now in the United States. And this is why Dr. Anthony Fauci warned earlier this week that he thinks masks will be needed along with the vaccines through all of next year of 2022. Last week, I reported about a recent Sunday, February 21st, audio recording by Steve Douglas, manager of the Deep Black Horizon blogspot that monitors aviation, space, military, and intelligence news. Steve recorded an American Airlines flight 2292 pilot over Des Moines, New Mexico, on a radio scanner.
Anthony, targets up here. We just had something go right over the top of us that, I hate to say this, looked like a long cylindrical object. It almost looked like a cruise missile type of thing moving really fast that went right over the top of us.
And then this CBS News headline was emailed to me from 3 years ago, dated March 28, 2018. Quote, two airline pilots report seeing UFO while flying over Arizona. Close quote.
Number 71 Papa Golf, good.
And was there anybody above us that passed us like 30 seconds ago?
Number 71 Papa Golf, negative.
Okay. Pump this. A UFO.
Yeah. Hey, it's American 1095. Yeah, something just passed over.
Don't know what it was, but it's at least 2,000-3,000 feet above us. Yeah, I passed right over the top of us.
A Phoenix New Times headline from the next day on March 29th, 2018 said, quote, pilots who saw the UFO over Arizona speak out. It didn't look anything like an airplane, close quote. According to radio logs that were recorded by the Albuquerque Center Air Traffic Control on February 24th, 2018, 3 years ago, near 3:30 p.m. local Phoenix time, two different airline pilots flying over Arizona radioed sightings of a very bright, unidentified flying object. And then a couple of weeks later, a recording of those pilots was released by thedrive.com, Phoenix New Times, and CBS News. And let's go over details from that February 24th, 2018 UFO encounter in Phoenix local time over the Sonoran Desert. There were two American airline pilots, one in a Learjet operated by Phoenix Air Group and American. The Learjet was working as an air ambulance for the military's Air Mobility Command. The Albuquerque Center Air Traffic Control heard the Learjet pilot ask about a strange, unidentified object. Quote, was anybody above us that passed us like 30 seconds ago? FAA replied, negative, close quote. According to the Albuquerque Center Air Traffic Control recording, less than 1 minute after the Learjet's question, the pilot of American Airlines Flight 1095 radioed, quote, yeah, something just passed over us. I don't know what it was, but it was at least 2,000 to 3,000 feet above us. Yeah, it passed right over the top of us, close quote. That American Airlines Flight 1095 pilot, Blennis Green, also reported that the UFO had a big reflection and was moving in the opposite direction of his flight en route to San Diego. Quote, this was bright all the way around. It was so bright you couldn't even make it out, close quote. The Learjet pilot and co-pilot were reported by the Phoenix New Times as putting, quote, their fingers on the window of the plane to estimate how high the UFO was in the sky, and they concluded it might have been flying at nearly 50,000 feet, which would have been more than 10,000 feet above them in their plane, close quote. Now, adding to the mystery of the blinding bright aerial object in February of 2018 and the cruise missile-looking UFO on February 21st, just a little bit ago, recently, I received an email from a resident of Brisbane, Australia. He gave me permission to use his name and excerpts from his email. Hi, Linda. My name is Sam West. I live in Brisbane, Australia, and 3 years ago, I witnessed an object as described in your recent February 24th, 2021, Earthfiles YouTube channel broadcast about the cruise missile-looking UFO. I'm not a pilot, nor have I been in the military, but I wanted to send you an email just to outline my own experience of witnessing a cylindrical object traveling at incredible speed during May of 2018. I was traveling along a fairly main, busy road at around 6 a.m. with only a small amount of traffic. I came to a stop at a red light, and then I saw at very low altitude, just above the tree line, and coming at incredible speed, a silver cylindrical object approximately 2 meters in length. The object was traveling so fast, I was only able to glance at its approach for a split second, turn my head to the main front window of my car, and catch one split second glimpse of the object before it had disappeared over a hill to the distant left of me. It appeared to be following the contours of the land deliberately. The following is what I know or saw. The object was traveling at incredible speed. The object was cylindrical, about 2 meters in length, but flattened to a flat seam at the front. It looked like a metal pipe that had been clamped or squashed at one end. The object had the appearance of being the color of very highly polished steel and reflective as the sun was glinting off it. The object had a vapor cloud or its own mini cloud at its front, which appeared to travel with it, as if the object was traveling so fast it had created its own vapor cone, or shock collar, as it's sometimes referred to. There was no sign of a means of propellant. There were no rotor blades, no jet engine, or expelled gas or gases at the rear of the object. The object was too narrow in height or width to contain a person. And even if it did, the person would need to have been in a prostrate position inside the cylinder. The object was traveling north to south as it crossed my path since I was heading west. It looked like a missile. Its path route suggested it had to be under intelligent control, whether at the object's point or remotely. It was the speed of this object that struck me the most. It would have had to be traveling at supersonic speeds and be able to navigate obstacles like hills and mountains with incredible ease and efficiency. So now we have the most recent Sunday, February 21st, 2021, American Airlines pilots report. And we have this one from Brisbane in Australia from 3 years ago, all about a cruise missile-looking thing in the sky. Well, I took all of this to Mark Wood, the U.S. Navy captain now retired at age 71, who has helped me on a number of Earthfiles investigations. Mark graduated in 1971 from Georgia Tech in Atlanta with a Bachelor of Engineering degree in aerospace engineering. The next year, he trained as an overwater navigator, qualified in celestial navigation. After being designated as a naval flight officer, Mark was assigned to a U.S. Navy P-3C squadron at Moffett Field in California. For the next 25 years, Mark flew over 3,000 flight hours in three P-3 squadrons as a mission commander and tactical coordinator, ultimately becoming both an executive officer and commanding officer of two U.S. Naval Air Reserve units. I asked Mark Wood about the recent February 21st sightings of a cruise missile-looking UFO reported by airline pilots over northeastern New Mexico and the one over Brisbane, Australia in May 2018. What could the cruise missile-looking aerial phenomena over populated human regions be?
The pilot compared this object he saw to a Tomahawk cruise missile, and that would be
a common thing to compare it to if he's experienced in aviation, because the Tomahawk cruise missile is a tube. And the reason it's a tube is that it's a submarine-launched and surface-launched cruise missile that's only used by the Navy. And it has to be able to fit inside a submarine torpedo tube, which is 21 inches in diameter. So the idea that it was like a Tomahawk cruise missile pretty much says that he saw a cylindrical object. Now, the only issue with that is that the Tomahawk, being a cruise missile, when it's launched, its operating envelope is between 30 and 50 meters, or 100 to 160 feet above the ground. And it's not designed to fly at altitudes where a commercial airliner would fly. The engine is not designed to do that. The fuel load is designed to keep it low and fly to a target and drop its weapon.
And Mark, isn't the low altitude of the Tomahawk cruise missile designed in order to avoid being detected by radar of a perceived enemy?
Oh, exactly. And any cruise missile, whether it's the Tomahawk or whether it's the French Exocet, are designed to stay low, to keep track of their position with GPS and terrain following radar, so they can fly a complicated flight path over the ground to a target and stay below the enemy's radar as it comes in from the coast to hit a target. So it's important for them to stay low, and hence the operating environment between 100 and 160 feet off the ground,
which is not 36,000 to 37,000 feet that was picked up by Steve Douglas in his trying to track what plane, what pilot was responsible for that quote. It looked like a long cylindrical object that almost looked like a cruise missile type of thing moving really fast right over the top of us. So what in the world would be up there looking like a cruise missile?
Well, nothing that I'm aware of in the inventory of the United States military. The cruise missile just wouldn't be at that altitude. It's not designed to be there. The engine and fuel and its range is designed to stay low. So in my mind, it's an unknown.
And it is also interesting that 3 years before, at almost the same date, it was February 24th, 2018. This one was Sunday, February 21st of 2021, the one that was compared to a cruise missile. The one 3 years earlier was a bit southeast of Phoenix. Those were two American Airlines pilots on that as well. But what they found was astonishing. It was up high and was so bright that they could not discern a shape. What is your sense about that corridor between San Diego, crossing Phoenix, going east, that in 3 years there would be these kinds of UFO reports seen by American Airlines pilots?
The thing that makes it a little bit confusing is we know that in New Mexico specifically, there are a variety of Department of Defense or Department of Energy areas where different tests of different types of equipment take place. The White Sands Test Range, Los Alamos, Alamogordo, and any number of Air Force bases. But anytime you've got any type of an object that is a flying object, you're going to test it in an area that you know has no flight traffic in the area.
Mm-hmm.
So why this would be in that part of the country from Phoenix up through New Mexico, I don't believe that we would test anything in that area for fear that if there was a malfunction, it could land in a civilian population or it might come in contact with a civilian airliner that's flying the airways in that region.
So you're reinforcing the possibility that both of them could truly fall into the unidentified flying object or unidentified aerial phenomena.
Oh, no doubt. To see an object that is a long cylindrical tube without control surfaces puts it in an area that I don't know how it would be controlled, because anything that we put in the air has to have control surfaces on it, whether they're small surfaces that you would see on a cruise missile or large wings like a B-52, because that's what keeps it up in the air. Now, we know that there are missiles that get fired from the ground, but the control surfaces are very small, and those tend to be ballistic. They're not flying at a horizontal attitude that they would fly over the top of an airplane like that. So in my mind, this is a completely unknown object. To test something like that in that type of a mode is not going to be done anywhere near a commercial flight quarter.
Where there are people who could potentially be hurt if something went wrong and it crashed.
Exactly.
If human governments would not be experimenting with these kinds of missile-looking whatever they are around the world in populated towns or cities, then what are these peculiar cruise missile-looking UFOs? I would love to hear from any and all of you who may be working professionally in military or intelligence or even retired with knowledge, that you could help fill in some of the gaps for me to understand this better. And as I have said in previous programs, I do get solid and substantive communications through proton mail. Sometimes establish a handshake with me through email, which is earthfiles@earthfiles.com, and then we could go to proton mail or communicate through hard U.S. mail or Federal Express. And it is with the help of some of you who have real, honest knowledge that I begin to understand the bigger picture and keep trying to bring puzzle pieces here and flesh some out. And hopefully over time that we are paralleling what will be finally official government confirmation that we're not alone in this universe, that there are a variety of various intelligences that interact with this planet, with the moon, with Mars, with Ganymede, throughout the solar system and beyond. And to catch us all up with everything that is actually going on in our own Milky Way galaxy, that would be the most exciting thing, is to learn all of it. Good, bad, neutral, hostile, peaceful, love, the whole enchilada. That's what I keep working for. And I thank all of you for coming on Wednesday nights and for getting my books and my documentaries and following up with really intelligent dialogues from a lot of you who are going through my large books and getting all of my documentaries. And I'm so grateful. Thank you very much. And Ian, I'm going to toss over to you to see what we have tonight for questions and comments.
Thank you very much, Linda. That was a fascinating report, and it was good to hear the captain's perspective on this phenomena as well.
Thank you.
First of all, I'd like to thank people in the Super Chat. Ginny McHugh, Dave Goodridge, Moonbird, James Thiessen, Chris Young, Vicky Martinez, and Carl Bittner. I'm sorry if I've missed anyone off there, but thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much. I just really appreciate it.
Okay. Linda, first of all, a lot of speculation and comments in the chat. A lot of people have had their own experiences, and they're very interested to hear more about what's going on. So thank you very much for updating us on what's going on. There's still a lot of speculation from the Terry Lovelace interview that we did a few weeks ago. People are still fascinated and still want to hear more and want to know if there's an update coming at all.
Yeah.
And also whether or not you're able to extend an invite to Betty, the half-grey hybrid, who is perhaps likely to come forward again with more information. Perhaps there would even be an interview with you at some stage. That's what people are speculating.
Well, Terry and I definitely will do
some more work together. He now is going through my books and documentaries, and he said, I'm in a deep dive like I have never been in my life about going into my work. And so we're then going to evolve toward a dialogue that will be even more multifaceted. And I think it is a legitimate question. Does he feel like that Betty would turn up again? And if so, is there any way for me to interview Betty through him? I've wondered about that. That's probably fanciful, fun thinking on my end, but eventually, maybe there will be interfaces with some of the beings that are only telepathic through humans who can get telepathy and then tell us. I know the military, our military has been doing that since World War II, of beings that they retrieved from crash sites. And then the beings they knew were telepathic, and then they have the challenge, how do you communicate the telepathy to a general and to a chain of command and all of that. And it's my understanding that with EBA 1 that was retrieved from not the July 1947 crash site, but another one that came later, that they took that being to Los Alamos. They kept one of the Air Force personnel who seemed to be able to get the telepathy very, very easily. And with pictures, he could see the pictures that the being was putting in his head very clearly, and stayed with him until June 18th, 1952, when the being died of unknown causes. And in those telepathic discussions, I have received information about some of the statements that the gray being telepathically gave in daily film, that they did daily film recordings with the, I know that he was at a captain rank later, that the Air Force man who was doing the telepathy said that the being was prolific in terms of trying to explain a whole lot of things about aspects of his planet, but said that he was just, quote unquote, some kind of a mechanical engineer. Well, if they did films for 2 or 3 years with the human translating the non-human's telepathy, somewhere somebody has all that material, and they would have definitely transferred it to more modern and more modern and more modern recording. And someday, I hope that the world will be able to see that kind of communication that we had in the beginning, that certainly seems like it would have represented a peaceful, not hostile, maybe not even neutral, but that is a big question. What is the reason for the interactions with our planet, Earth life, and the history here on the planet? And my, as I understand it, answers to those questions, some of them are in the, all of the filming that they did with that EBA 1. So there's, to be able in to interview Betty through Terry Lovelace, wouldn't that be something?
Yeah, well, we would really look forward to that interview. That would certainly boost the subscription figures as well. Anyway,
I'm only saying it in a way. I'm trying to really underscore what a huge disconnect our planet has, that there are beings, but my even saying that, see, it seems impossible and ludicrous. And we've got to evolve to a point where being able to communicate even through an intermediary would become possible. That's why I'm saying it sort of as a almost like a joke, that this is how disconnected we are, when in some distant future we may finally be connecting through telepathy and human translators.
Also, a comment in the chat says so this is the 70th anniversary of the film The Day the Earth Stood Still.
Oh,
that would make 2021 a synchronous year for disclosure.
Well, and I have been told, and one of our colleagues in England has been told, Robbie, that the day the Earth stood still was a paid-for, requested Central Intelligence Agency script working through a cutout company in Los Angeles in order to produce the film, The Day the Earth Stood Still, with Michael Rennie and the robot. And that the idea was that the CIA wanted to test what the American general public reaction would be to the idea of an extraterrestrial landing with a robot with warnings about the future of the planet and what we were doing, and that they were not going to allow atomic bombs. Remember, that was sort of the overarching big picture of The Day the Earth Stood Still. And if that was the test back in, it was 19, was it 50 or 51 that it was first released?
51, I believe. That would make it exactly 70 years.
And that was a test. And already we know that Missouri was really first. And that was in the 1941 April, if the people who had those dates are correct. So if April 1941 was the first that FDR and Truman and the Cordell Hull, the Secretary of State, and all of those people were having to deal for the first time in their lives with three clone beings that were retrieved from the Cape Girardeau April 1941 period. And that means that there was an entire decade from 1941 to 1951, 10 years, that would have included Roswell in July of 47, but was not singular at all. It's just what leaked, and that's why the public knows about the Roswell Daily Record headline. But in that decade, there were many other things that were happening. And so it makes sense that maybe they were even contemplating, do we tell? If we tell the American people, we're telling the world. And maybe there were World War II post-year issues about which other countries they didn't want the information to be shared. But by the time that you get to 1951, The Day the Earth Stood Still would have been sort of a logical time period for a government concerned about how do we tell the public, and then whatever they judged from the film, the answer seemed to be to go on for more decades without telling the truth. And so here we sit today in 2021, and we still have not had the confirmation that other life forms from this universe have been coming and going and based on and manipulating, terraforming, harvesting this planet, as that DIA guy told me, for at least 270 million years.
Okay, I've got a question now from a viewer, sparked probably by the rebroadcast that you did about the Men in Black a couple of weeks ago. Linda, do you think that the MIBs could have agendas other than covering up contacts? Perhaps they have longer play preparing, perhaps they've been longer play preparing the Earth for contact in a certain prescribed way.
I understand the question.
Yeah, I think they mean pre-preparing the Earth for contact in a pre-prescribed way.
I understand the question. I just think of all the people that I have interviewed who have discussed having a man in a black suit, sometimes with a black hat, sometimes wearing sunglasses, appear at the foot of their bed. I have a drawing of one of those in my Glimpses of Other Realities book, Volume 1. And therefore, whatever they are, which could even be sophisticated holograms designed to upload and download information, the men in black have never been associated with kindness or compassion or anything that you would put in the category of an intelligence that wanted to reach out to humans in a, I guess I want to say, in an intelligent and thoughtful way, and say, we are the cyborgs that represent this planet, and we're here because, sort of the way humans sort of fantasize that we might have discussions with non-humans. And the very fact that the men in black are and have always been associated with fear, people afraid of them, not understanding why they show up, I would say that they might be in the category of making humans afraid because whoever they work for in the non-human side has made some kind of an agreement with our government or other governments, and they want genetic material. They want minerals. They want from our planet. And to get along, to go along, it may have been that there really have been one or more treaties, and the treaties would insist that the non-humans leave Homo sapiens sapien alone. Let's just speculate on that. So the men in black could have been androids programmed by some progenitor intelligence to try to keep a distance, always sort of scaring humans away. That's the way I look at the men in black. If there is anybody listening who has other information, especially if you have had a military or an intelligence background, I certainly am open to other information. But Ian, you know what I'm talking about. They've always been associated with intimidation.
Right. And often the threats, if they're face down, don't ever come to anything.
Right.
I have to add that bit as well.
Yeah. Okay, what about another?
Okay, sorry, the next question then. Linda, several people have books depicting specific aliens and their ships. Have any of your whistleblowers relayed any specific information of this nature?
Meaning, what specific question?
I think that what they're getting at here is, are they tying any specific species of alien or types of alien to any specific types of craft?
Oh, okay. I can share what I have been told over the years, but things always change, and you never know whether a source said X in order to cause Y that was a deflection versus just getting straight facts. But Jim Sparks, who I worked with before he did his book, The Keepers, and he contributed a very large chapter in my Glimpses of Other Realities, Volume 2, about his interactions with both reptilians and what he thinks at one point might have been the Greys. So there was a mix. He said that the one, I guess it was a communication where he was puzzled that a ship that looked like an ice cream cone, rounded at the top, and it was hanging down like that. And there have been a few reports through the years referring to this ice cream cone shape. He said that he was told very specifically, now not by different types of aliens, that he was told by a man who did work in Washington, D.C., who came and befriended Jim Sparks. The man from Washington seemed to be extremely interested in the interactions that Jim Sparks was having, and told Jim that in a particular interaction that Jim Sparks had had, that the ice cream cone were or was reptilian. And Jim was so definite about that, that I'm sharing that with you as one of the first strong ones that came, that I don't think was a deflection. I think it probably relates to something truthfully told to Jim. The others that come from a variety of sources break down that the first Roswell craft that crashed in Roswell were not round, even though the Roswell Daily Record of flying disc, what I've been told is that if you took a, let's say, a soft-boiled egg, so think of a soft-boiled egg, and then take your hand and start pushing down on that egg and just push and push until you can get it flatter without it cracking open, that the flattened egg is one of the craft that is associated with what are called the EBINs, which is a government acronym, extraterrestrial biological entities. Those are EBINs. One distinction that was made for me a very long time ago and seems to be reinforced by a variety of modern communications is that even though the human mind eye sees beings that are thin, maybe somewhere between 3 and 5 feet tall, the human mind locks on to the color of the skin and calls them grays. And one of the more interesting distinctions made by some people in the military is they may all look, when you don't know anything, they may look like they're gray, all of them, but that the distinctions between those that have a large bulbous head like that and that it comes out back here with lenses on eyes that can look like a cat's eye underneath the lenses, and that the chins come down like a pear, are not pointed, that those are the EBINs, and that they have four fingers, the EBINs. And then the EBINs refer or have communicated with people in our government that they are enemies of the grays. So to humans, it's a booming, confusing, buzzing. But the more I have studied and the more people I've interviewed, I begin to see these differences. There are beings with pointed chins that may have gray skin, and people who have humans, just regular humans who have dealt with them, consider them to be more aggressive. Whereas the ones with the big head like this and the round chin, sort of like a pear, if you put where the stem of the pear would be here and the pear would be up here, that those are EBINs, and that the EBINs are kind in some instances. Words like that have been used, that some humans have felt that there is a caring. But, and here is the bottom line on both the grays with the pointed chins and different craft and the grays that come in at least ovals, which I think are the flattened eggs, the EBINs, is that the EBINs, like the grays, will lie.
I've heard this from several people who have worked in military situations and know something about the Ebens and the Greys. And that's one of the things that you will hear. I think they are allies, but they lie. And you can go on the other side of that word lie, L-I-E, and say that when I take chocolate to the vet, he's right here if you can't see him on the screen, I wish that I could communicate to chocolate that I take him in to get shots and he hates going to the vet like all cats, but that I have another knowledge level. The human has a different level knowledge to their dear pets about how to keep them well. So sometimes I wonder if the metaphor is relevant, that some of the Ebens are extremely worried about what humans are doing to the earth. That is one of the most common themes. And that the Ebens are not going to allow us to go into nuclear war because that would destroy the earth, which, as one man said to me a few years ago, when it comes to extraterrestrial interest in this solar system and the earth, he said, the planet trumps humans. In other words, we are a species of life and we live on the surface generally of the planet. The Ebens have bases in mountains and underground. They've been here for a long time, way longer than the last 45,000 years of the crossfade between Neanderthal and Cro-Magnon, Homo sapiens sapien, which we are that current type. And I can sort of understand that if there have been a variety of species of advanced intelligences who analyze suns and solar systems and for 270 million or more years have explored this arm in the Milky Way galaxy where there are 19 yellow suns like ours, and there may be something about the temperature of those yellow G suns and planets that maybe they're very conducive to various life forms, that if we knew the truth, if reptilians and tall Nordics and grays with pointed chins and gray Ebens with rounded chins and tall red hairs, and the list goes on and on and on, I can understand that the Earth, as a laboratory for the creation of all kinds of genetic manipulative species, as well as a place to harvest metals and various things that are of importance to them, I can begin to understand what that man meant, that when it comes down to which will they save, they want planet Earth to keep going as a laboratory, which then moves all of us over to the other side of the equation. Hey, governments, tell us the truth. If we're not alone in the universe, if there are many different types that are very interested in this planet and one or more made this current human standing up primate species, tell us all of the truth. Tell us all that's at stake. Tell us everything you know about what is coming. And if the timelines are constantly in a circle, Roger Penrose and others, then where are we on the current circle? What do the non-humans know that the rest of us don't know? And how much would humans pull together with each other if we knew all the truth about the relationship of other intelligences with this planet, this solar system, who made us and why? And that we are a conscious species that seems to have been given a very strong soul. And to come full circle back to the first EBA one, that one of the things that I remember so much was the being told that the Air Force guy asked EBA one up at Los Alamos, what about reincarnation? Is reincarnation real? And this seemingly kind, gentle Eben, communicating telepathically, said, reincarnation, the recycling of souls, is the machinery of this universe. Wouldn't you like to be able to sit down with these beings and see what they have to say about this universe? Boy, I would. So, Ian, back to, I would love to interview Betty with
yeah,
Terry.
I think so. That would be a great show. Thank you. Okay, Linda, with the passing of the 40th anniversary of the famous RAF Bentwater incident here in the UK, do you think that the highly advanced, that the contact at Bentwaters may have been a highly advanced alien probe from an intelligence that hasn't visited Earth yet? What are your ideas on this?
Remember Lynn Buchanan, who was the professional control remote viewer who worked in Stargate with some of the others like Joe McMonagle and Pat Price? And Lynn Buchanan, his relationship to what is coming and ETs and this whole process was, I just had a thought explosion. Give it to me again. I thought of Lynn in okay. Just tell me the question again.
Okay, the question was speculatively about the contacted RAF Bentwaters.
Oh, yeah.
Could have been a highly advanced alien probe from the intelligence that hasn't yet visited Earth or hadn't until that time.
Yeah, I did several interviews with Lynn, and that's why my mind went off to one interview. Okay, but we did a fascinating, in-depth interview about Bentwaters because John Burroughs received information that the CIA had released Lynn Buchanan's controlled remote viewing on the black triangular object in the forest at Bentwaters. And in that, and in an interview, I've done it at myearthfiles.com for anybody who wants to go in, just type in Lynn Buchanan, you can read the whole thing. He was seeing the bright blast of white light. And then Lynn was inside of the craft, the way they do when they're remote viewing. And he saw a black box, and there was something about the black box that was crucial. And then Lynn got the distinct impression that it was all AI. The craft was artificial intelligence, knew how and what to do, where to go on the earth, everything was the craft, was the intelligence. Inside of the black box was genetic material. And Lynn saw images that the craft was looking for places that it could deposit the genetic material in the black box in a variety of places on the earth where it would take hold and evolve, but he didn't know what the life was or why they were doing that at Rendlesham. He also had the impression that if the craft was the life or was AI, very sophisticated AI, And it had a mission having to do with depositing genetic material for an experiment. The question has always been,
who are the progenitors behind all of the craft that are totally functioning? There's many cases where military people are told that the craft is the whole thing, and that where there are small grays or those panels where the hands would go in, the way it's been explained to me, the craft and the beings that are also AI, the beings are artificial intelligence. So you have AI dominating some of these craft and trips to Earth, and we may never ever know who the progenitor civilization is that sent out all of these different craft and different beings, and that's one of the great mysteries. Who are the progenitors? Who are the true progenitors that built pyramids, not only on Earth, but the one in Cydonia on Mars and probably in a lot of other places? It's like we see our history just through this teeny, tiny, tiny, controlled, kind of held in place little lens on our history. If it goes back a billion years or 500 million years, what all has happened on this Earth throughout the solar system, throughout this arm of the galaxy, through the Milky Way galaxy and it others communicating with other galaxies, what all has happened prior to 45,000 years ago when Neanderthal and Cro-Magnon did a crossfade, and for reasons unknown, Cro-Magnon, Homo sapiens, sapien survived to evolve, and Neanderthal didn't. So, Bentwaters, I've always said, I think it's one of the most important of all the cases. But from the remote viewer's point of view, it wasn't weapons. It wasn't related to back engineering weapons testing, which a lot of people think. It had to do with a genetic depositing program. So that's Lynn Buchanan. Ian.
Well, thank you, Libby. You made a very good point there. And the progenitors for the AI probes may even be themselves from long dead civilizations, which have long gone.
Yeah.
So thank you for that.
Yeah. And I wonder, we're getting close to the end. Is there one last good question?
Yes. Well, it's a bit of a fun question, really, with the news about the Japanese billionaire sponsoring his own SpaceX flight. If you were given a ticket, would you accept a ticket to fly with him, Linda?
Oh, wow. What, another SpaceX ship blew up today? I don't think...
A Japanese billionaire.
I know, but it's. I'm thinking of today there was news about another blow up of one of Elon Musk's. And where I was headed was, I don't know yet if humanity's craft ships are ready to start taking people. I don't know that I'd be comfortable there. But I would certainly be comfortable if I was introduced to somebody non-human who my soul felt was not hostile and friendly. I'd like to go on one of their craft that can go in a few seconds from here to another star. That I would like to do.
Well, that's something for the future. So, you know, that's certainly happening at the moment with the Japanese billionaire. Apparently he's trying to recruit 8 people to go with him on a flight.
Well, not me this time around.
Yeah, I don't think we would blast you off into space just yet.
Yeah. Hey, listen, you guys, send me your questions, your comments. Ian helps me go through them. And all of you who still may not have hit that subscriber button, please do. It doesn't cost anything. It's just the idea of us growing and growing so that in terms of the YouTube world, that we have some oomph to a group that continues to get larger and larger. And with your help, we can make that $175,000 for the March 24th show. And I think it would be fun. We'll do another, some kind of champagne celebration and figure out something fun to do with all of you guys. And in the meantime, on the side of the fun, this is evolution time, revolution time. I think most of the abductees that I talk to, they either having dreams or they feel that we're getting close to at least finally opening up what has been so clear to so many people since World War II, that we're not alone in this universe and that other intelligences are based here and interact here, and that what we are doing on Wednesday nights, what other people are doing, it's as if we are reaching out for that handshake. We want a handshake with the truth, and we want a handshake with those other intelligences that share this universe with us as conscious intelligence. And that I think all of us would rather think that we are in a universe where love and light and life are respected by those who also live in other solar systems and other galaxies. And that it isn't a universe where war is everywhere. And that on our planet, we seem to be at that kind of crossroads. Which way are we going to go? And I hope that some other intelligence who knows more than we do could be introduced to us in a positive way, open up the chapter of humans discovering they are not alone, and that this universe, even if it's a holographic universe being projected from another dimension, it's glorious with its photons and its deep mysteries, and that humanity, us humans, we are worth struggling for to get over on the other side that doesn't have to war or kill. And I think like some kind of life form that is learning to stand on its feet, that's what I pray that we do, that we are going to evolve together as a humanoid life form that's going to meet other life forms, and that it will be richer and better, and that ultimately, if we all understood really what happens at the moment of death, really what the value of our individual soul is, that there are other beings that do not have these souls and may want what we have, if we knew that for a fact, and every human on earth could embrace every other human, that would be the future to struggle for. See you next week. I love you guys.
Turn on closed captions for YouTube videos by clicking the white CC button on the lower right. The default language for Linda's videos is English. If you would like to see the captions in another language, click on the white settings button next to the CC button. Select subtitles CC, and then select auto translate. Select a language, and the captions will now appear in that language.
sort of gone through and they will hold their heads. I never had a cat do that before. And they'll pull against the comb, helping me get out snarls. And I think it's the best they've ever been.